Bethel World Outreach Church. Reaching a city to touch the world.
So not to belabor any more points and get straight to what we're going to talk about, let's go to Hebrews 11. We're continuing our Great Faith series because this has been a word and a theme that God has given us. It's not man's idea. It started in prayer at the end of prayer meetings last year, dropped the word in Pastor Steve Murrow's spirit a year in advance of something that we would need to lean on. Characters and people we've chosen, they seem to be obscure and ordinary. Character we're going to talk about today is Abraham and a little bit of Sarah. He doesn't seem obscure. I mean, he is probably one of the most dominant characters of faith that you can think about. Considered the father of faith. And we hadn't really spent any time dealing with him and his life yet, but I'm going to show you what God the Holy Spirit gave me from the text. Now, I'm not even going to have you read the text, but I will walk you through the text. And let me help you understand that there's no way when you look at Hebrews, these nine verses that we'll kind of go through, that you can get to the entire narrative about Abraham's life and the impact and all the dynamics. So what I have done through the grace and leading of God is to narrow this narrative down to three things we need to focus on. There's a lot of little moving parts that you can get to. I'm going to skip all over them, okay? And so because it's just too much text, but this is what the Lord gave us to cover, and we can actually do this and achieve this. We're going to talk about Abram's life, and what you're going to see is these three things. He had to take a faith step. He had to take a step. Many times we think about his life and we think about the end of his life, but we don't think about the beginning process of faith. He began somewhere, and the place he began was very imperfect. He didn't have absolute or complete obedience or complete faith in the beginning, but what he had was enough to take a step in the right direction. And here today, I'm just trying to get you to the place where you don't have to be Abraham and you don't have to have all the results of his life, but we can come to the beginning of his life and see that there was a step. But along the way, he moved from steps with God to being in a place from God where whatever God says, he received wholeheartedly to the degree that he could not be chased off of the fact of the truth or the promise that God said. So faith receives what is promised. How many times does God have to say the same thing to you and I over and over again for us to get it? And whatever he said in the beginning of your life at your dedication, or whatever word has been over your life, it's the same word. It did not change. We'll see that through Abraham. Now, it's added to, but it doesn't change. The third thing you'll see is that even though you achieve receiving the promise through the word of faith, it doesn't take away the reality that you're going to face tests. And perhaps these tests are not initiated by your enemy, but by God. So faith, pure faith, at least takes a step in the direction that they're called. Faith has to mature. The word has to mature to the point that you can receive the full revelation without taking from it or adding to it. And finally, when you get there, don't be surprised if you have to take a test. Why are we looking at Abraham? Because out of all of the world religions, of the top eight or the top seven, Judaism, Christianity, and Islam are all connected. And they're connected through a common denominator, a man of faith, Abraham. And there are some people who are of a different faith than Christianity, who only take his ethnic heritage. And then there's the Christians who take the spiritual heritage of Abraham. And I hope you can see a bit of the difference today as we go through the text. Let's read together this first two verses. I'm going to say ready, read, and you guys read with some unity, clarity, some diction. You can, you know, some inflection if it's appropriate. Ready, read. So let's start by seeing what caused Abraham to obey by faith. If Abraham was obeying something by faith, that means he received some instruction or some direction. What was the words that would cause him to act or to take a step? We find these words in Genesis 12, 1 through 2, and then we're going to contrast it between Acts 7, 2 through 8. And I'm going to show you a little point here. The Lord said to Abram, go from your country, your people, and your father's household to the land I'll show you. I'll make you into a great nation. I'll bless you. I'll make your name great, and you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and whoever curses you, I will curse. And that's a friend. And all peoples of the earth will be blessed through you, Abram. So Abram went as the Lord had told him, and Lot went with him. Did he say Lot was supposed to go? I said, did he say Lot was supposed to go? Now, what did he just tell him? Huh? Leave who? Did he leave his family? But he's the man of faith. Have you ever heard the Lord tell you to do something and then turn it into something you could do instead of something he asked you to do? Do you find yourself in that scripture right now? I'm leaving on. Abraham was 75 years old when he set out from Haran. Now, to know what's going on, you have to also go to a New Testament part of your scripture to see that when God first came in his glory to Abram, Stephen was giving this account. He said that he appeared to him in Mesopotamia and told him to get away from his family and his people and go to a place where I would show him. But where God is speaking to him is in Haran. You see, Abraham first received the word, and he could only act on a portion of it. Because sometimes God will ask you to do something that's so overwhelming to you, so life-changing to you, But his word is so dynamic to you that you've got to do something, but you can't do it all. Abram acts, but he can't get the whole thing right. Have you ever felt that way? Like, you know what the Bible says, you know what God wants you to do, you're so overwhelming what it is he's asking you to do that you can only pick a small portion and say, I'll at least do this. And then that whisper comes of the devil that says, you didn't do all God said to do. And instead of feeling good about your step of faith, he makes you feel bad about the direction. I'm going to tell you, I venture to say it's a demonic attack and a demonic scheme to make you feel bad when you can't do the full thing God asks, but you are doing something that God asks. And what the enemy tells you is that something is really nothing. And I'm telling you that something you're doing on the way to the full thing is making progress. Faith steps toward God. You can't get the full thing on the first day. And guess who knew that? God himself. And he still chose Abram. He's still choosing you and I. And maybe when he called you out to be a leader, you feel like you lag behind instead of ahead, but you keep showing up at church. You keep on praying for people, but you haven't done the dynamic things he wants you to do. You're getting to it. So you didn't give up on him. So now when he's 75 years old, he's visited at the halfway point. He didn't make it to the promised land. He's in harem. And God does something powerful. He repeats the word to Abram. I love this about God. When he makes a decision about your life, Mario and Karen, when he makes a decision about your life, he's not fair weather. He's not making the decision to give you a gifting and a calling and then change his mind about it because you didn't get it right on the first day. Raise your hand in here if you got everything right on the first day you were introduced to God and his will. Raise your hand up. Let's see you. Let's see who you are. Because we're going to knock that pride right off of you. No one is at that level. The word comes, and see, faith comes by hearing, and hearing the word of God over and over and over again. And the more you multiply hearing the word, the more you have opportunity to act in faith. And eventually you get there. I love that God doesn't leave us in a culture he doesn't want us to be in a household he doesn't want us to be in a polytheistic environment he doesn't want us to be in an immoral household he doesn't want us to be in, where sacrifice of humans and worship of demons is okay. He won't leave you in that situation. And maybe you're in here today and you feel a little disqualified when you come to the house of God because of how you were raised. You feel like you're discounted, but I'm telling you that Abraham wasn't raised like a good little believer. Abraham was raised like a good little pagan, and Abraham was introduced to the glory of God even before he knew who God was. God knows how to invade your space and invade your place and to bring a word to you that brings you out of the things that he don't want you to be in. And even though Abraham couldn't get it together on the first day, God still shows up with a word that says your life is worth redeeming, your life is worth working for and working out. And he begins to speak to him. God is speaking to you, church. I don't care if you've forgotten what he said. I don't care if you've given up the dream or the vision. I don't care if you only got one step, two steps, or went back a step. God is still with you because his word doesn't change, and he's giving you a word to act on. He gave it to Abram, and guess what? I'm here to tell you he's giving it to you again. Here, you're a leader. You're a life changer. God is redirecting your course. He's getting you out of the bad patterns, bad behaviors, the generational curses of your past, and God is fixing it and erasing it and eradicating it, and he's doing it one step at a time. Oh my God. Okay, just one step. Just take one faith step. Abram at this point is ordinary. Abram at this point is just a family man. And I like some things about Abram. How many of you were able to just radically break free on the first day of hearing? Most of us weren't. You know how you were raised? It's so deeply seated, deeply rooted. The hooks are in us so deep. I can tell you how deep they're in. With me, my son, you know, you get to the family reunions and your kids start looking at you. I didn't know you did all of that. I didn't know that was still in you. Who are you? You can get around certain ones of your kin folks or your friends, and the old stories come out and you start acting like your old man. And then you start learning that scripture, evil communication, corrupt good morals. It don't take but one phone call, one hanging out with one person on social media, getting in touch with my past, and all of a sudden something wild is triggered on the inside of me. And instead of getting right with God, I'm getting jiggy with it. I'm getting all messed up and you know, see, it doesn't take much. But God keeps giving you a word that keeps you on course. The word is a lamp to your feet. It's a guide to your path. Abraham, you may not be getting all the way where I want you to get, but you're at least pointed in the right direction and you're headed there. And if you just stay with me, if you keep that ear open to hear and you let that ear hear the word, I can keep you. I can keep you. Faith takes a step. The step is obedience. What are you saying? Well, Pastor James, aren't you saying he was disobedient? He didn't get rid of Lot. He didn't get rid of his family. He kind of went to the wrong place. I'm telling you that the process counts. Abram didn't become Abraham overnight. You're not going to walk into your full identity overnight. And though this world tells you to be great instantly, there's hardly anyone who's great instantly. or does great things instantly. Faith, he said, the just shall live by his faith. Faith is a way of living. It's a lifestyle of hearing the word of God over and over and over again. When God showed me, I have time for it. No, I don't, but I take it anyway. God showed me that what I would be doing in my life when I was 20, you know, being in churches, overseeing churches, being part of global mission, all that. When he showed me that as a little inner city guy, just only knowing my little world, my little block, never having been out of the state, the world, you know, just maybe Memphis, that's it. Which is like baby Detroit. I know Memphis people don't get hurt. It's baby Detroit. I'm sorry. No, I'm not. Baby Detroit. But when you hear the whole thing and you look at yourself, Abram, you look at yourself, James, when you look at yourself, you don't look like what he's speaking to you. And something in you resisted. But every time you just take the smallest step forward, he meets you. Now, we know as the story goes, Abram's character gets revealed as lacking some things that are consistent with God and his glory. Lies about his woman, fails to protect her, and then lives a time in ambiguity about it. He's apathetic, he just can't get away from his kinfolk. You know, sometimes holding on to our culture and our ethnic paradigms is more important to us than progress in the kingdom. Well, you know how we are, black people. I like it on the 2 and the 4. You like it on the 1 and the 3. And I'm happy as long as the environment is turning its direction greater toward me. See, that's holding on to your home. That's holding on to your culture. That's holding on to your ethnicity more than your call. He was going to be the father of many, many. All nations of the earth were going to be blessed by him. You have to depart then from certain ways of thinking and certain ways of living. And I'm going to have to kind of purge you of some stuff. Don't despise the purging process when you take the steps of faith away from what is familiar. Don't despise it because we're not talking about your ethnic group as much. We're talking about the world a little bit more. Abraham, I want you to focus on nations. I want you to be focused on the father of many. Why aren't we focused on my nation? Why aren't we focused on my problem? Because that's not spiritual thinking. It's not spiritually inspired. It's not God's best for you. And God begins to give Abraham a vision more consistent with himself and his will for him than what Abram saw in his own life. And as he progressed, you find him lying and having all type of character flaws. But God does not change his mind about who he wants him to be. Now, we ought to pause before we move to the second point and just imagine that. No one knows all your sins. Because one thing I learned about human beings, we are excellent at hiding sin and iniquity. I know it's not a lot of amen on that because we're hiders. We hide sin well. You know who knows? God. You know who still chooses us? God. And he knows. And you know what he does? When Abram finally moves out at 75 years old, he starts getting to the land of Canaan. And when he finally gets to the land of Canaan, God starts speaking to him more. And you know what God does? He said, I want to go deeper with you. I know it took you a long time to get to a certain destination, but now I want to cut some covenant with you. I want to take it from words, and I want to obligate myself at a higher level. I'm going to make an unconditional covenant with you and with your seed. I'm going to make an unconditional covenant that there's something that I'm going to do for you and require nothing from you. Not something, but nothing. And he cuts all these animals up, and he comes through these animals like a flaming torch, declaring the word of covenant to him and what he's going to do. He goes deeper in his ability to do what Abram's character showed he cannot do. But yet he is the father of faith. It doesn't matter how many times you've disappointed yourself. It doesn't matter how many times you've disappointed your family or failed. Get up, because a covenant-making, covenant-keeping God is still interested, Bethel, in your life, in your call, in your destiny. Come on out of the dark and start walking in the direction of the light. So it gets to our next point, and I say this, he receives what's promised. To have received what's promised means you accept something, you welcome something, you ingest something, you take something wholeheartedly. When I say he receives what was promised or receives a promise, it simply means it's no longer just words out there. To Abram and Sarah, what I'm about to go through is factual to them. It's real. Say, by faith, verse 11, by faith, Sarah herself received power to receive, to conceive. By faith, she received power to conceive. You know, Sarah was barren, her womb unfruitful. And this for many years. It made her crazed. It made her do things that were inappropriate, make decisions that end up harming her family more than help her family. You see, when we get impatient in the process with the promises of God and we make another way, we add on problems. Sarah went to her husband Abraham and said, "Hey." He said, "Yeah, babe. What's wrong?" "I'm just tired of not having kids." "No, honey. Didn't he promise us? Didn't we come out here? Didn't we do it? Didn't he say he'd bless us? This is not blessing. This is not blessing. And you need to do something, Abraham. Do something." And then Abraham, "What you want me to do, man? I'll do anything you want me to do. I've been thinking about this." "There's a law in this city called Hammurabi. And like, you can just give one of your slaves and they can bear your children for you. But I don't want you to be impure, so you have to marry her. Her name's Hagar. I picked her. I've already talked to her. She wants to do it. Because you said you'd do anything." And he moved from the promise to a fleshly decision. That means when it's a fleshly decision, the appetite of the flesh is involved. It's no longer what God wants, it's what I want now. And the Bible says sin entered the world through lust, and lust is to superimpose your will over the will of God. And now he obscures the promise instead of receiving the promise. And now he receives a woman to his bed. He has a child, only to find out that it makes his wife more angry, which is a lesson, man. You can't handle the two thing. Let that go. It's never worked out in scripture, not one time. "Well, I mean, I did, but I can try. No, you can't. Don't you? I'm reading it to you. There's always some lie that says there's another way other than the way God had planned for you. And God's statement is, "That's not what I promised. That's just a problem you created along the way to the promise. And because I don't say something I don't mean, I'm going to stick with the promise and I'm going to allow you to have to deal with the problem." I beg you, church, receive the promise helps you avoid the problems that the flesh will create. And when we don't obey and get in a faith rhythm, because the just live by faith, the only thing you can exchange it for is what you think and what you feel and what else is suggested and what the culture is doing and what they allow and how somebody else defines life and how somebody else defines love other than God. And you begin to think you have permission to do everything, and you start avoiding a life full of promise, and you get a life full of problems. But she finally received the promise, because she got so frustrated that God showed up when she was 89 years old. God showed up when Abram was 99 years old. And when he showed up and started talking to Abraham at this point, about his ability to make the promise to make his name great and give him a seed that would possess the land and go into the land and be a point of promise, he heard Sarah laugh. Here's why she laughed. Romans 4. I enjoyed that too long. Say, bad preacher. Romans 4 says this way, verses 19. Without weakening in faith, he faced the fact his body was as good as dead. Abraham said, this doesn't work. I don't work. I don't know what to do. All I can do is look at her. Since he was about 100 years old, see? And Sarah's womb was also dead, yet he never wavered through unbelief regarding the promises of God. But he strengthened in his faith and gave glory to God, being fully persuaded that the God had power to do what he had promised. He didn't waver through unbelief. He didn't consider his body that was dead. He faced the fact. Face it. If there's something dead in your life and working outside of the word, will, and promises of God, call it what it is. Our relationship is dead. The love is gone. It's all right. Face it. If you're sick in your body, don't play around with it. Well, I don't want to say I'm sick, as if that's going to make it go away. Okay, let's not do that. And I'm just trying to upgrade you if that's been part of your narrative. Face it. If they say you have some, face that. Just deal with it. When you deal with it, you face the fact, but you speak the truth. My body may be sick, but by stripes I'm healed. That's how you deal with it. You deal with it with a faith response, not with a dismal, just lose it. No, I'm not sick. That's sick. You sick. Why is it important to call it what it is? Because you won't know when the resurrection happened. See, you have dead business. You have dead calling. You have dead bank account. It's on negative. But God showed me that whatever fact of your deadness you're facing, it does not trump the truth of his word that he has spoken over this church and spoken over your life and given you through fasting and said before you were born, before you were in your mother's womb, he ordained you. He has plans for you, a purpose for you to prosper you and give you a hope and give you a future and make you great and make you a blessing to bless others. You have a word in your mouth. You have a calling in your heart and you have a destiny to fulfill. God is with you. Nobody can be against you. See, these words cannot be changed by the deadness of your life, by the deadness of your body, by the deadness of your heart, because last I checked, he says, I'm the resurrection and I'm the life. He that believes in me, even though he was dead, yet shall he live. If you're dead in here today, I'm saying rise up in the name of Jesus, because there's a word of faith that we can focus on and not the deadness of your body. He did not waver. That's how you know they received the promise. See, when you really receive it, and somebody tells you, you're not going to do that, you laugh. He doesn't make a promise he doesn't keep. You see, Abraham had transcended just thinking about the earthly land of Israel. The Bible says he sojourned in this land. He didn't own anything except the plot of dirt that he bought to die in. He was living in tents. He lived in tents the whole time. You see, he died not having physically obtained the promise, but he saw it from afar off. I'm getting to the third point, sorry. He saw it. And he believed that it was his. The Bible says that God showed up and preached the gospel to Abraham in advance. He stopped recognizing it as his ethnic group that was the primary people that God was going to say. And he started seeing that the seed that he was talking about was Christ. The promise he was talking about, the inheritance he was trying to give, was spiritual. It was redemption from the deadness they were spiritually. And God was trying to resurrect his dead spiritual condition and the spiritual condition of humanity. He was giving him something far greater. He was giving him more children than you can ever imagine. Guess what? Anybody that names Christ is a child of Abraham. And what a great inheritance. What a great heritage. But if the seed of his faith lives on the inside of me, then it's a seed that points to the faith in Christ. And believing by faith is counted as righteousness. And that same seed of faith that produced countless stars in the sky, countless sand on the seashore, countless souls saved, countless people coming into the kingdom. That same seed is on the inside of me. And whatever Abram's simple life could produce with all of his weaknesses, my simple life can produce the same thing because the same seed of Christ abides on the inside of me. What am I trying to get you to understand, church? If God is for you, who can be against you? It's not too late to give in. It's not too late to say yes. It's not too late to get active, to get involved, to say yes to your calling. There's too great a God on the inside of you to stay apathetic. You need to get up and be who God called you to be. Nothing can stop you. I'm so out of time. You got to stand up for me to close. The final thing that happened to him was he was tested. He took the very son that he was promised. And said, go sacrifice him to me on the Mount Moriah. Put that picture up, Mount Moriah, for me. The greatest conflict in our world today is on that Temple Mount. Before it was a dome of the rock there built in 691 by Islam. This is the spot that he took his son Isaac with wood. God said, sacrifice him. And he got to a point where he was with his servants and he got tested. The scripture simply says in closing, by faith, when he was tested, he offered up Isaac. What did that test look like? Genesis 22:1 says it this way. Sometime later, God tested Abram. He said to him, Abram, here I am, he replied. God said to him, after all his victories, after the child was born, take your son, your only son, whom you love, Isaac, and go to the region of Moriah, where that little Temple Mount is. Put that picture back up. Keep it up. Early the next morning, Abraham got up and loaded his donkey. He took him with his two servants and his son Isaac, and when he had cut enough wood for the burnt offering, he set out for a place that God had told him about. And on the third day, Abraham looked up and saw the place in the distance, and he said to his servant, "Stay here with the donkeys while I and the boy go over." And this next verse tells you something unique about Abraham. It tells you the test was not passed when he laid his son on the altar. The test was not passed when he raised the knife to his son. The test is passed right here. He said, "We will worship and we will come back to you." He had discovered something about the character of God. God was not into human sacrifice. We know that God would have a ram in the bush. God would have something. And the Bible says that even if he would have taken Isaac's life, he said he would have raised him back from the dead. He received him figuratively raised back from the dead because he counted God faithful to his promise. See, he passed the ultimate test. And at the greatest point of conflict on this earth, the Islamic community controlling the top of the Dome of the Rock, where the spot where Isaac is with and Abraham's there with the knife over him, and it's the most holy site, is where the Temple Mount was built by David and Solomon, purchased by David, built by Solomon. The Jewish quarter is controlling the Western Wall on the bottom, and the Christians just trying to get in where we can fit in. In the greatest conflict on earth, the greatest tension on earth. But if I was there to solve the conflict, I would say y'all missing the point. The point is greater than a piece of land. The point is that Abraham, your father, he saw a city whose builder and maker was God. He had the gospel message. He knew that the seed was Christ. He knew about Messiah. He got it. He knew there had to be a lamb. He knew he was looking for something greater. So those communities that are trying to work their way to God, you can't do it. I spent part of my life trying to work my way to God. You might be here today trying to work your way in his heart. What if I can just stop sinning? What if I can just stop cussing? Just stop smoking? I got some good news and bad news for you. You may struggle with those things for the rest of your life. Isn't that bad news? Like, man, you could potentially struggle with a vice for the rest of your life. Here's the good news. You have a Savior who knew you might struggle and went and paid the price for your sin. He gave you grace, space. He blotted out your transgressions. He cast them as far as the east is from the west. That is the good news about it. Instead of giving you a penalty, he gives you a reward for accepting him. And that's eternal life. Ministry team, come down. In a message like this, you can have a lot of things swirling in your head. So for some of you, it's just confirmation that you're headed in the right direction of faith. For some of you, it's an acknowledgement that you just are at the point of failing the test because you got disillusioned, because you thought you had it all together with God, but pressure came. And you thought it was the enemy, it was God saying you're about to graduate to another level. The answer never changes. And the answer for Temple Mount is New Jerusalem. It's a heavenly kingdom. It's a risen Savior who sits upon a throne that cannot be moved. If he is not Lord of your life today, you need to make him Lord. If you don't know how to make the next faith step, when I say the conclusionary prayer, you need to make a faith step down here. Not maybe to get saved, but just because you need that feeling that I'm going in the right direction with God. And maybe if you've been struggling with the promises and your identity, maybe you've been like Sarah laughing, but you need to receive that final word from God that gives you confidence. I'm with him. He's with me. And I want you to believe.
If you've watched this message and you want to make Jesus Lord of your life, I've got good news. You can do it right now. I want you to pray with me. Say, "Lord Jesus, come into my life for the rest of my life. I acknowledge I am a sinner. I need you, my Savior. I believe you died for me. I believe you were raised from the dead on the third day. And I confess that you are now Lord of my life." If you've just prayed that prayer, I have good news for you. You have eternal life. The next step for you is to get in a Bible-believing church. We volunteer to be that church. But if not us, We pray God's blessings on you as you search for God's best for you. Thank you.